Charms for the Easy Life by Kaye Gibbons. Already by her 20th birthday, my grandmother was an excellent midwife in great demand. Her black bag bulged with mysteries and vials. This occupation led her to my grandfather, whose job was operating a rope and barge ferry that traveled across the Pasquotank River. My grandmother was a frequent passenger, going back and forth over the river to catch babies, nurse the sick, and care for the dead as well. I hear him singing as he pulls her barge. At first it may have annoyed her, but soon it was a sound she couldn't live without. She may have made up reasons to cross the river so she could hear him and see him. Think of a man content enough with quiet nights to work a river alone. Think of a man content to bathe in a river and drink from it too. As for what he saw when he looked at my grandmother, if she looked anything like my mother's high school graduation photograph, she was dazzling, her green eyes glancing from his to the water to the shore. Imagine what my grandfather felt when she told him her name was Clarissa Kate, but she insisted on being called Charlie Kate. She probably told him that Clarissa was a spineless name. Now some facts of her life I have not had to half-invent by dream. She and my grandfather were married by a circuit rider in 1902 and lived in a tiny cabin on the Pasquotank, completely cut off from everybody but each other. My grandmother continued to nurse people who lived across the river, and soon Indian women in the vicinity came to prefer her root cures to their own. My mother was born here in 1904. She was delivered by an old Indian woman named Sophia Snow, thus her name, Sophia Snow Birch. They left Pasquotank County in 1910. Grief over the suicide of Camellia, my grandmother's twin sister, made it impossible for her to stay there. The sisters were so bound together that as small children, when they slept in the same crib, they awakened every morning, each sucking the other's thumb. Grief for Camellia hounded my grandmother from the place her family had lived for five generations. My grandfather did not want to leave Pasquotank County, but the government's decision to scrap the ferry for a modern steel bridge satisfied my grandmother's urgent need to leave. She was so relieved that her sighs all but created wind. The only decision they needed to make was where to go. They chose Wake County because my grandfather was convinced that this was a place overflowing with gorgeous opportunities, even for an illiterate barge operator. On the way to Wake County, something happened. They stopped and cut a man down from a lynching. This poor man was alive, but barely, and after my grandmother rubbed voice back into his throat with her bare hands, he sat up and regarded the botched execution with great contempt. He rode with my grandparents the rest of the way to Wake County, sitting beside my mother in the buggy. He told her again and again, "They will come and look at that tree and have to wonder. I bet they'll bet Jesus took me down. They won't come looking for me now, not with the power of God in me." He thanked my grandparents with a railroad watch, a tin of excellent snuff, and an easy life charm he pulled off a greasy thin chain around his ankle. The charm, he said, was the hind foot of a white graveyard rabbit caught at midnight, under the full moon, by a cross-eyed Negro woman who had been married seven times. He then walked around this part of the state for the rest of his life with a thick scar around his throat, singing my grandmother's praises. He talked his salvation into legend. My mother's family didn't arrive poor in Wake County. My grandmother's savings, as well as the stock she inherited from a wealthy landowner whom she once treated for syphilis, made her a woman of surprisingly comfortable means. but because she lacked the social position commensurate with her robust financial portfolio, she couldn't live in the surroundings she deserved. Instead, she purchased the best house in the Bill Street area, the worst part of town. My mother always approved of this, saying, if we had moved where my mother could very easily have afforded, nobody would have played with me. Daddy would have had nobody to drink with, and she would have had to suffer notes on the door telling her she couldn't plant that much bloodroot and sassafras in the front yard. My grandmother soon created suspicion within the neighborhood anyway. She woke up one morning to find a petition nailed to her front door. It read, "The radio caused it, so get rid of it." 10 neighbors actually signed the petition, or rather, 6 signed and 4 X'd. The week before, she had acquired a radio, which ran off a low wire strung across the backyard, and that weekend a tornado touched down and leveled a row of shotgun houses. It reduced many people with next to nothing to nothing. And then somebody must have asked the question, what spoilt the sky? I imagine somebody recalling the wire stretched across the new family's yard and thus the petition. My grandmother solved this matter by inviting people into the house one evening to listen to her radio. And while they were there, she removed warts, cut out bunions, mixed laxatives, and applied a salt and soda swab to a hideous case of pyorrhea. My grandfather delighted the men in the crowd with samples of Pasquotank moonshine and empty promises that there was plenty more where that came from. By 10 o'clock, my grandmother was having to push a host of new loyal patients out the door, along with their inebriated husbands and my mother's sleepy new playmates. My grandfather scrounged around for work. Finally, he took a job he loathed, saying it was thoroughly beneath his dignity. The longer he worked this contemptible job, the more dignity he imagined he'd lost. He was, for want of a better term, a gopher for a blacksmith. He wasn't allowed to shoe the horses, just tote the ashes. As he became more and more frustrated with his life, he became, understandably, more and more unbearable. My grandmother secretly withdrew her affection and offered more of herself to caring for my mother and her patients. She developed a fantastic trade with sick people coming forth like the loaves and the fishes, putting one real doctor in such danger of losing his patients that he sent her a nice note and a $10 bill. This only encouraged her. As time passed, my grandparents had less and less to say to each other. There was no fighting. Since they couldn't find anything between them they cared enough to fight about. And after just 2 years in Wake County, they were at the point of completely wordless meals, wordless evenings, wordless Sundays. My grandfather was destined to leave this sort of situation, so he left. He left the way sad men leave. He did not come home from work. How did my grandmother react when her husband let his supper get cold? She let his dishes sit at his place overnight, and then the next morning she threw them in the sink and broke them every one, yelling, "To hell with him!" My grandmother had no friends or acquaintances other than her patients, so there were no rounds of explaining to be made. Nobody would be watching her to see how she managed. Nobody would note the breadth of her pride. Well, nobody except my mother, who watched and learned. And this is what she learned. A man will leave you. My mother spent most of her childhood riding back and forth to funerals in Pasquotank County. Although the suicide of my grandmother's sister had driven her away from home, she was called back several times to wash the bodies of other relatives who had done the same thing. In 1917, she buried 2 cousins who became despondent after they read their father's name on a wartime casualty list. The ground opened up and swallowed them, standing together reading the wall. That evening at supper, somebody broke a pitcher, And these girls secreted the glass into their bosoms and went down to the root cellar and used the fragments. A year later, my grandmother went for another burial, taking my 14-year-old mother with her to sit at the wake and occupy her mind writing morbid poetry in her diary. The uncle my grandmother washed and laid out had spent the last 5 years of his life so bent down and twisted back on himself with arthritis that parts of his body...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.